Ladies and gentlemen, hello. Welcome all to this great initiative of the Hellenic Centre in collaboration with the Society of Modern Greek Studies, which aims at introducing to you modern Greek writers whose poetry has been translated and published in English. My name is Despoina Papastathi, and I teach modern Greek literature at the Department of Greek Philology of the University of Ioannina, Greece. I will be sharing with you today my thoughts on the poetry of Kiki Dimoula. I will be reading poems to you, translated in English by well-known translators and writers as David Connolly, Cecile, Inglessis, Margellos, and Rika. Kiki Dimoula was born in Athens on 6th of June in 1931. She was the eldest daughter of Christos Radus and Helen Kalamariotti. In 1945, she meets for the first time Athos Dimoulas, who is going to be her husband in 1954. Athos Dimoulas was a civil engineer and a published poet. Kiki used to say that Athos was as important to her as were her legs, her arms. He was her perfection. Athos played a decisive role in forming her personality, as Dimoula didn't hesitate to confess. Together, they had two children. Athos Dimoulas died in 1985. Dimoula was devastated. In an interview, 9 years after his death, she admitted that his loss was still making her suffer, that her grief was incurable. She worked for 25 years at the Bank of Greece, the country's central bank. She was seconded for 8 years at the office of the bank's magazine, The Cycle, under the guidance of Nassos de Georgis, an important Greek writer and publisher. Dimoula, during that period, wrote for the needs of the magazine more than 100 texts in various prose genres, chronographs, in memoriam, travel writings, diaries, interviews, impressions of musical or theatrical performances, exhibitions of paintings and sculpture. Dimoula's reputation had been firmly established by the 1960s, and she has received many awards, such as the Greek State Prize twice, the Grand State Prize, the Uranis Prize, as well as the European Prize for Literature. She became a member of the Athens Academy in 2002, the third woman to be elected at the literature chair. She passed away at the age of 88 on February 2020. Her death caused great grief to all of us. Kiki Dimoula published her first poem, Shadow, in 1950 in the literary magazine Nea Estia by her father's name, Kiki Rado. From 1956 to 2016, she wrote and published 14 poetic collections. Many of her poems have been translated in foreign languages, such as English, French, German, Danish, Swedish. Kiki Dimoula's poetry is a representable case of the elegiac tonality that characterizes Greek post-war poetry. Poetry becomes a testimony of the Greek post-war ideological, social, cultural crisis. The dramatic historical events affected the majority of the post-war poets, leading them to try to interpret by their poetry the area that Takis Sinopoulos, another great Greek poet, calls the death zone, in Greek, περιοχή θανάτου. Mourning and the grief for the loss of a person are expressed by the poetic genre known since Greek antiquity as elegy. Elegy reveals an ancient relationship between literature and loss, and consists of making physical, material works of arts out of the very event that destroys our own physicality, death. Elegiac poetry is both a private record of the transition from the passive state of bereavement to the personal work of grief, and the public, published performance of communal rituals of mourning. Death, the void caused by loss, the feeling that time is running out, hold an important place in the poetry of Kiki Dimoula. The poet seems reconciled to the agony of the unspeakable, the absence. The poetic narrator lives with the ghosts of the past, the loved ones who were lost, the hopes that were denied. The degradation of the death rituals, the contradiction of body and soul, the frustration of the erotic experience and feelings, the dominance of grief and melancholy, the catalytic influence of time, the rejection of the soteriological dimension of the Christian myth, the appropriation of the ancient Greek myth, are some of the thematic motifs that distinguish the poetics of Kiki Dimoula and express the elegiac temper of her writing. The fate of people is common, so no matter how hard one tries to preserve one's future, no matter how much one seeks to protect it from death, it turns out that what will ultimately prevail over everything, dreams, vows, memory, faith, agony, boredom, everyday life, words, silence, is one, pointlessness, as we read in the poem entitled Common Fate from a collection, The Little of the World. The poem comes from the volume The Brazen Plagiarist, which is published by Yale University Press, and it is translated by Cecile Inglessis Margellos and Rika. Common Fate. My roads, your roads, and this. He, I, and this. The bridegroom maze, the appropriate attire, and this. The non-combatant feeling, the hidden knife, and this. The advancing thirst, the Samaritan woman, and this. The longevity of dreams, the assiduous of hopes, and this. Oars vaulting over time, the deciduous memory, and this. The necessary sun, the sudden good mood, and this. The yellow leaves contending to fall valiantly, the song that steals their souls, and this. The drought, the rain, and this. Your anguish, my anguish, and this. The statue's initiation into our own rituals of boredom, the sacrifice of yet another Iphigenia to one more third gate gust of wind. And this, the training of words to pass through silence, the training of silence to pass through words. And this, the strictly guarded future and its final abduction by this, pointlessness. The main subject of Dimoula's poetry is nothingness, as Nikos Dimou, a Greek writer, has indicated. It is the fact that our existence is not a real existence. It's a precarious existence. It's always undermined by the thought of death, by time, by decay. Like Emily Dickinson or the great Greek poet Konstantinos Kavafis, Dimoula has her own very single, very specific, very individual voice. That voice is constantly melancholic, even from her early writings. Now I'm going to read for you the poem Melancholy for the poetic collection Erebus, 1956, translated again by Cecile Inglessis Margellos and Rika. Melancholy. In the sky, heavy darkness walks a tightrope, and at the window takes me into its embrace. With one of my hands into the room I drag the street's inconceivable bareness, while with the other one I grab a handful of cloud mist, and with it seed my soul. In that poem, the melancholic temper of the poetic narrator is expressed symbolically by the bareness of the room and the street, in combination to the metaphorical picture of her soul, full of cloud mist. Death, loneliness, grief are expressed in Dimoula's poetry by repetition, ellipses, opposites such as hope, despair, existence, inexistence, while rhetorical figures as metonymy, metaphory, and irony play a major role. Irony emphasizes the skewed perspective of a world that is dominated by grief. Hail Never, poem from Dimoula's homonymous poetic collection, reflects emphatically the ironic view of a world where the dominance of death is catalytic. Dimoula refers to the Christian myth, and especially the psalms of Orthodox Easter, questioning the soteriological dimension of them, emphasizing the ephemeral of human nature, highlighting the ironic vision of the world and the degradation of the traditional values. Dimoula honored the memory of Athos in that collection, published in 1988. In an interview at the New York Times on 11th of January in 2013, she admitted that when she was writing that book, all she was thinking was, how could you get back what has disappeared? And that all her poetry is about that concern. I'm going to read for you the poem translated by Cecile Inglessis Margellos and Rika Lesser. Hail Never. Tonight, the salutations came to an end. Those I'm sending you are endless. And hail, hail, divine willingness, refusal to convey them to you. Violets fall into a savon. From the mild weathers, embrace, understandably tight. It hasn't seen them since last year. Hail to you, flowers, constancy, in your regular return. Hail, no returns, constancy, respectful of the death to the letter. Hail, darkness, embrace, that you welcome, understandably tight. It hasn't since you since before you were born. Hail your eyes, fear of opening. Hail the unhoped for promise, full of grace, that someday your grace again may take courage and open a path to materialized gaze. Hail your eyes, fear of opening. Memories free pass for a lost day's dawn, to go see them whenever it likes. As for you, world, consenting to live as long as fortune needs you, so hardships reap the fruits of your fertile endurance, abasing yourself to live, so that a ventriloquist full moon may bid you good evening during transit, what more can I say? Hey, you too. To the question why the readers feel intensely her poetry, especially in such dark times as we are in our days, Dimoula used to say that people thought of her poetry as a consolation, even though she herself is inconsolable. What is so important to the readers about her poetry is that she derives her themes from what was happening in everyday life. She used to say that she had no visions, that she wasn't a visionary poet, and that she wanted to transform reality into something less real. And she managed that with her unique poetic language, which made critics to compare her poem's form to that of a fugue or to pop art, or define it as surrealism of grammar and syntax. For Dimoula, language is her homeland, her identity. She wrote a number of poems which help us to light her vision on poetry by letting us to enter in her poetic laboratory. Dimoula defends her choice to everyday's life themes in the poem entitled Program of Study from the collection Greenhouse Grass, published in 2005. I'm reading for you the poem translated by Cecile Inglessis Margellos and Rika Lesser. Program of Study. Time I submit my thesis to you, with you as its basic subject, since what I am now arrived here thanks to you. My nature had no means to send me abroad for the study of higher illiteracy. Here I stayed, rending a low-selling internal history course. I followed it a cheap method of study without a teacher, and every without in general, which is a method of broader learning. What I went through is beyond words, impossible to reach the difficult chapter without importance. Whatever was with for me was without for others. And while I studiously wandering gave me a zero. I proved my grade by wondering again about your method. Time to bring changes without reason, that right away to take back, erasing completely the previous gentle form things take before they are learned. And even now, growing old with the without method, I shrink, get confused, wonder how even the withouts have changed. They were not so frequent. How death has changed. It was not so frequent, when warmly introduced me to me by love. The poet, by using the metaphor of the journey, confesses that her nature made her choose an internal history course and choose to write about time and its effects. As a reader, she criticizes her poems strictly. What was of no importance to the other was sufficient for her, especially death. The thousands, beauties, and the precious ugliness of the world are the center of Dimoula's poetry, as we read that her poem entitled The Finder's Reward from the homonymous poetic collection. The poems are the finder's reward, which pictures the poet's relationship with herself, with the surrounded world. Dimoula managed to reduce the individual pathos and attach anxiety to collective. The poem is translated by Cecile, Inglessis, Margellos, and Rika. The finder's reward. Thumbing through, you hesitated now and then in your reading, as if something had got to you unread. The pages were secretly laughing. Then you weighed them all in the palm of your hand, as if they were coins, and made a rough estimate, not so few, you said. Surprised, how did you come by them, you asked me. Hypocrite, you haven't read a single line, or else you would have seen it's the first thing I wrote. They are the finder's reward. You gave them to me because I found you. I took account and you were numerous. Account again and you were otherwise. I lighted you to be both one and the other. I didn't subtract a single one of the thousand beauties you possessed, nor one speck of your precious ugliness world. In the same poetic collection, the brazen plagiarist is the writing that copies the civil war between existing and ceasing, between life and death. Of the unremitting civil war between existing and ceasing too, between speaking and ceasing too, finally, the only winner is that famous war correspondent writing. A brazen, unholy plagiarist, it copies both speaking and ceasing to exist, expertly forged as lasting in the paper's closed mouth here. The existential questioning of Kiki Dimoula is deepened in her dialogue with the art of photography. Photography is an elegiac art, a twilight art, since photographs are memento mori. To take a photograph is to participate in another person or thing's mortality, vulnerability, mutability. Precisely by slicing out this moment and freezing it, all photographs testify to time's relentless melt. Dimoula's dialogue with the art of photography reveals a grammar and an ethics of seeing. I'm going to read for you the poem Photograph 1948 from the poetic collection The Little of the World, translated by Cecile Inglessis Margellos and Rika Lesser. Photograph 1948. I'm probably holding a flower. Strange, a garden must have gone through my life once. In my other hand, I hold a stone with grace and defiance, no hint whatsoever, no forewarning of changes, no foretaste of defenses. Ignorance must have gone through my life once. I am smiling. The curve of the smile, the wholeness of this mood, resembles a well-stretched bow. Ready. A target must have gone through my life once, a defense for victory. My gaze, sunk deep in original sin, tastes the forbidden fruit of expectation. Faith must have gone through my life once. My shadow, the sun's mere toy, wears hesitation's uniform. It hasn't yet had time to become my companion or my traitor. Sufficiency must have gone through my life once. You are not there. But since there is a cliff in the landscape and I'm standing at this edge, holding a flower and smiling, you must be coming soon. A life must have gone through my life once. The title, Photograph 1948, gives us both the narrative frame, which is the depiction of a photograph, and the placement of the poetic story's time in past, 1948. The first person, poetic narrator, describes herself in the photograph as happy and smiling, young, believful, ready to win in every task, ignorant for the difficulties of life. The repetition of the phrase must have gone as a leitmotiv in the end of every stanza of the poem, such as a garden must have gone through my life once, or ignorance must have gone through my life once, and finally, a life must have gone through my life once, underlines ironically the emptiness of the present, the contrast between photograph and reality. What the photograph reproduces to infinity has occurred only once. Photographs mechanically repeat that could never be repeated existentially. A photograph is both a pseudo-presence and a token of absence. Photographs may be more memorable than moving images because they are a neat slice of time, not a flow. Each still photograph is a privileged moment turned into a slim object that one can keep and look at again by looking at photographs. We are moving back in times, looking for the truth of the face we had loved. And now I'm going to read you the poem Zero Star Brandy from the Quetti collection Hail Never, translated by Cecile, Inglessis, Margellos, and Rika Lesser. Zero Star Brandy. The tears words get completely lost. When disorder speaks, order must keep silent. Loss has great experience. Now we must stand by pointlessness, so that memory gradually may regain its eloquence and give good counsel on longevity to all that has died. Let's stand by this little photograph that's still in the bloom of its future. Young people, somewhat pointlessly embracing one another in front of an anonymously cheerful beach. Nacleon, you be as Kopelos. You'll say, where wasn't there sea back then? Of particular interest in Kiki Dimoula's poetry are her ekphrastic poems, in which the poet speaks about her remarks on a painting or sculpture, and the reader's audience listens and sees what the work of art means. Ekphrasis uses one medium of representation, in particular in words, to represent another. Sculpture contributes to our understanding of the way a given poet perceives his own art. In this context, the poet may use particular characteristics related to the practice of the art or required for its appreciation, or he may use sculpture as a metaphor of poetics, or he may wish to turn sculpture into a symbol, or finally, he wants to show all the above with a specific work of sculpture in mind, in which ekphrasis adds a further dimension to the association of the two arts. In Kiki Dimoula's poetry, the sculptures are divorced from their true histories and emptied of their individual meaning, allowing the poem speakers to occupy this negative space with their interpretation and elegiac mourning. The symbolization of the sculpture we are described in Dimoula's poetry is dependent on the ethics of Dimoula's seeing. Either they are placed in archaeological sites or museums, or in public squares, or in the gardens, or on the shelf of a library, decorating the inner of the house, under the eyes of many visitors, of the passing people, or of one individual only. The readers easily identify the ekphrasis of famous sculptures of the museums of Delphi, Olympia, or Mykene in Greece, or of squares, as the one of the Klathmono Square in Athens, in the poem Dance of the Fanciful, Sculpture in Klathmono Square, from the poetic collection The Lethe Adolescence, which I'm going to read for you in translation by David Connolly. A group of three dancers, figures of the same height, of equal stature, the movement and grace, joined above by a powerful flinging of the arms and their cleansing in closely woven coordination. It could be the mother, daddy, and child, in a wheel of reciprocal settlements, or two truths dancing with each other. And the third figure, the serious reason why they found no partner. Yet, whether because the morning square is perfectly clean, you can find thrown on the ground even half a passerby, or because the shrubs and the light circulate only the inner zone of your eyes? I called the group male, female, and think of beauty. Of the three of them, I found the think of beauty infinitely more beautiful, extending everywhere the fleeting angular square protected full lunar elliptical profile of its interfinableness. Whereas beauties male and female have the large locating nose, their continuality half open, slightly stupid certainty. The poem Dimoula is emptying of meaning the object of art. The sculpture of Clathmona Square, since she rejects the sculpture symbolization, who made the statue to remind us the value of the reconciliation after the end of the Greek Civil War. Dimoula fills the empty space of the meaning by projecting on the sculpture the beauty of the ephemera and the uncertainty of love. The poetry for Kiki Dimoula is the unfortunate gift to anticipate, to predict the difficult situation around us, the decay caused by time, the gap between life and death, the frustration of love, the despair of loneliness. Kiki Dimoula defines the poet as a porter of melancholy. In Greek, we say athophoros melancholias, whose main mission is to carry, to express the sorrow of the inevitable fate of ephemeral nature. That's why readers gave Dimoula the most central place in their hearts, since she taught them with her writing the most difficult to learn and accept lesson of life, death. Thank you so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed the presentation.